rundown for the service. We'll have our announcements. We'll have kind of shortened praise and worship time because we are looking forward to having the Fisher family share here this morning. And there will be a lot of praise and worship with them. When it's time, I will give time for announcements and then like a prayer for the offerings. And one of those is for church, for the Gospel Express, which includes the Fisher family, and the other is for Destination International, or we call it DNI, to the mission outreach of the GMA. So if you have an announcement you'd like to give, we have a portable mic. So I know Wendell had one. John, you go ahead right now.
There is a little bit of an issue for those watching online. It might get a little bit blurry when we're doing the Fisher family is up front. So I just thought I'd let you know and apologize in advance.
So can they hear us right now?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. The reason I ask is go ahead, Wendell, with your announcement, and then I have a couple of proposals as well.
I would like to draw your attention to number one in your bulletin. Sold Out will be this Friday night and Saturday night at Fairview. Sold Out is a ministry that Rick Rhodes is a part of. It involves preaching. The Sold Out Conference is, we are all welcome to attend that and encouraged to attend that. And we especially would encourage our youth to be there. This year's theme is a missions theme called Help Wanted. So each evening there will be two sessions along that theme. And I believe Friday night, there's also an ice cream social afterwards. So avail yourselves to that. And I believe Saturday afternoon, Pathway Gym is going to be open for any youth who want to come play volleyball. I believe there will be youth around from maybe Missouri and other places for this conference. So we'll give you something to do in the afternoon on Saturday. But please take a look at the poster on the bulletin board that gives any more information on there that I'm missing, or come ask me if you have questions. Thank you.
Youth is anyone under 30, and the rest of us are welcome to be there as well. I don't have a set date on you. Today is Lavina Hostetler's birthday, and she turns 99 today. So I think Lavina can hear us, and when we sing happy birthday to her, I would like to have happy birthday, Lavina, and we'll go from there. Sometimes we shorten her name, but we're going to use the full name like her mom would have probably. So, all right. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Lavina. Happy birthday to you. All right, thank you for that. On the right-hand side of your bulletins, number six was changed just recently, and we didn't let Mary know in time to get it changed here, but put down November the 7th for the Pathway ASAC Supper fundraiser. So that is Thursday, November the 7th. Are there any other announcements? Okay. None will come and lead us. all be able to worship you together, to glorify your name, as we sing a song to glorify you as our King of Kings and Lord of Kings. We ask that you pray this in Jesus' name. I'd like to have us all stand, for we will glorify. And then they will be coming forward as we sing this song. We will glorify the King of Kings.
Yes. Well, good morning to all of you. So good to be in Iowa this morning. I expect everyone here this morning noticed what a beautiful morning it was. And boy, is it ever. It is so beautiful outside. But so good to be here. Thank you for allowing us to be here and to come and being here this morning. You know, as we were singing that last song, the last song that the brother led anyway, was talked about worship. Come and worship. Folks, this morning, that's our desire. It's such a wonderful thing to be gathered together on a Sunday morning and to worship. Now, we do a lot of singing through the week and different times throughout the week. But, you know, Sunday mornings, there's no other place that we'd rather be than in the house of God. There's something special about a Sunday morning. The first song that we sang, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. You know, we're well aware this morning that when we receive Jesus into our hearts, He sends His Holy Spirit to live within us, and we become the sanctuary of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that amazing? Amen. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. How can the God of the universe humble Himself and put His Spirit inside of a vessel like mine? Got so many things, so many issues. We've got failures and shortcomings and weaknesses, yet God sends His Spirit to live within our hearts. Isn't that a marvel? And I treasure that this morning, and I hope that's a treasure for you. But as we think about worship this morning, let's open our hearts to God. Let's allow the Holy Spirit to go in and out of these rows of pews this morning. Regardless what you're facing, regardless whether you're on a mountaintop, whether you're in a valley, whether you need encouragement or whatever it is, the Holy Spirit, through song, through the Word, can minister to you this morning. And I just invite the Holy Spirit here that as we worship, that He will minister to every one of us and meet us at our point of need. He's so good at that. So let's open our hearts to Him.
Oh,
All right, we'll do some real brief introductions here, just so you know who we are. We don't really expect you to remember our names. That's not that important, but we are the Fisher family. We're currently serving with Gospel Express Ministries, which is in the foothills of North Carolina. As you come down off of North Carolina into the foothills towards South Carolina, that's where our office is, and that's close to where we live. Now, most of the people, when you think North Carolina right now, what do you think? Storms, don't you? Well, we were actually, our community was not in the heart of the storms, but we were right in the area, and some very unfortunate things took place right there in our neighborhood, in our community. Thankfully, most of us from Express didn't have significant damage other than trees down, lost power for a week or some 2 weeks. When you think about it, pray for those folks in North Carolina. I'm telling you, there are people that have lost everything. And, you know, I'm sure you've seen pictures, and pictures still don't do justice to really being there. We have the privilege of going in and out of some of those communities, serving food and helping out with some cleanup and that kind of thing. But the devastation that's there, there are people that have lost houses, cars, have actually lost real estate. They have no place to rebuild because their real estate is gone. The river just completely took anything that was close by. So, wow, we wonder why, yet we know that God is in control. God is sovereign. The next song talks about that, that our God reigns, and regardless of what we face, God is on the throne. Yes, there are things that devastate us at times, but we have this confidence that God is in control. So that's where we're from, and this is our family. We do a lot of traveling. We do a lot of what we're doing this morning, get into a lot of prisons, and just get to see a lot of countryside, a lot of good folks, and what a privilege it is to be able to travel and to minister in this way. So this is all of our family. God has blessed my wife and I with 5 children. My wife, Verna, we've been married for 28 years. And she stays really busy when we're traveling or when we're home, cleaning, laundry, cooking, homeschooling, just to name a few of those things. She's really good at all of those things. Our kitchen in the bus is rather small, but you'd be surprised what comes out of the kitchen. I'm up there driving, and there's some amazing things that come out of that kitchen. So that's such a privilege to have her for a wife, and she's so supportive. And does so well with her responsibility. Our 3 young men here, Eric is 25, Caleb is 20, Austin is 19. And when we're at home, they have part-time jobs. And the Lord provided so graciously, gave us a gracious boss to live for, to work for, that says, hey, when you're home, you can work. When you're not here, then obviously we do without you. So God has been so good to us in regards to that. And then our 2 young ladies, Harmony is 11 and Kimberly is 9. And our youngest member of the family is out of the bus. It's actually a puppy. But we don't generally bring her home safe. She stays out of the bus and out of sight for the most part. But brings a lot of joy to our family. Something about having a little puppy running around that welcomes you every time you get to the bus is like, that's just all right. So the order of our program this morning, we're going to do a few more songs, and then we're going to show some slide pictures, show you some products that we have with us, and then after that we'll do a PR video which takes you into prisons, it takes you to our office in North Carolina, and takes you across the world into Africa, and just some pictures to help you see some of the things that we as a ministry, by God's grace, are involved in. So let's continue to worship. We're not here to entertain you. We're here to lift up Jesus Christ. Our God reigns.
Thank you.
face to us. You know, if we could roll back the cloud and see into heaven, Psalm gives the idea that at the top of our ladder, or at the end of our life, there are angels that are holding the ladder for us. So, you know, every day that we live, we climb one step higher, do we not? And, you know, some of us, we don't know where we're at on our ladder. Some of us are maybe close to the top. Others of us maybe have a long way to go yet. But wherever we are, regardless where you're at on your ladder, don't lose heart. Keep climbing. You know, I know life sometimes throws us things that are really, really difficult. And there are people, sadly there are people that get to the point in life where, you know what, it's just not worth it. I'm going to turn around. I'm going to turn my back on God. It's just not worth it. But if you've ever been in a place like that, would encourage you, if you're there this morning, I hope you're not, keep climbing. Keep persevering. Take that next step. Gets us one step closer to glory. It's at the top where we're headed for. Friends, someday this will all be over, and we will get to the top of the ladder, and we'll receive our crown, and we'll see Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So wherever you are on that ladder, keep climbing. The angels are there cheering you on. Take courage. Keep climbing that ladder. All right, we're going to go into a few slides that we have here. I think I'll stand over here. Yeah, we can have a few lights off, maybe. All right, as we came in, the table in the back has some product on it. This book is on the table back there. The book is written by Dave Miller's oldest daughter before she got married, and has a lot to do with father and daughter relationship. So we have that book with us for sale back there if you're interested in it. And another book that we have, this book was released last year. It was written by Dave Miller's wife, Ruth Ann, asked a lot of questions. And it has to do with how to relate with children, small children. There's actually a little book trailer that talks about it, that explains it a whole lot better than I can.
Is the simple, thoughtful question many children long to be asked. The value of knowing what is going on in our children's lives and processing the good and the hard with them cannot be overstated. Staying in tune with each other by taking time to ask specific questions is essential to keeping an open relationship.
And intentionally taking time to really listen to your child's heart could change the course of their life. A lot of experiences in a child's life can be resolved more easily when a grown-up can help coach them through the emotions and thoughts within the current circumstance. By periodically taking time to ask children specific questions, we can activate their conscience to discern both good and evil, demonstrating how to keep a clear conscience and process offenses in a healthy way.
Whether you're a parent, grandparent, or mentor in a child's life, this date book was developed to make it easier to reach your personal relationship goals and have fun doing it. Imagine the memories you will create by going to 5 to 10 new places together that year while learning more about who they are and what's going on in their life. It is a user-friendly book that can be written in and checked off to help you keep track of multiple children and the dates taken with each one. The subject questions are specifically customized for 5 age brackets: preschool, elementary, middle school, high school, and career age adults.
In each age category, there are 10 dates that ask intentional questions surrounding different subjects, with a few fun and silly ones to sprinkle in wherever you want. Exactly where and how often you meet is up to you.
In this process, you may become aware of areas you were not nurtured as a child. This interactive date book was crafted with your needs in mind as well as your children's. We hope you, as the adult, can take a few minutes to pause in the parent tip section to reflect on your own heart's well-being before you care for your child's heart.
Not an avid reader? No problem. This book can be used without reading any of the parent tips and simply grabbing the book on your way out the door for your date. Included throughout the book are QR codes linking you to videos with teaching helps and personal testimonies on specific subjects.
We hope this book of questions can be a tool God uses to help you have the least regrets possible as you release your child into their future. No matter what your story, your next step to leaving a legacy of intentional relationships may just begin with a listening ear and a thoughtful question. one child at a time.
All right, so that's what that book is all about. If you're interested, we have copies back there. We have a copy that's actually open. You're welcome to pick it up, page through it if you like, and we have it for sale. Some of the recordings we have, this is obviously our family. This was released just this past February. It's the only recording we have. We've only been with the ministry for almost 2 years now, a year and a half to 2 years. And so we feel like we're still really, really new at it. A lot of things we don't know. And we find it such a joy to be able to work with the Miller family and to walk alongside them. They've taught us so much. This is their latest recording, the Miller family, Because He Lives, was released last year. One before that, King of Kings. And then prior to that, Call Me Higher. The one on the right is a instrumental only. And then Nelson and James. Most of you probably know who Nelson is. His last recording, Nelson and Sarah, there on the left, I Want to Stroll Over Heaven with You. Then Nelson and his nephew James did a bluegrass recording. And the Salsu's family, no longer with our ministry. They felt God's calling them to stay at home. He's actually a pastor in their local church, so they're no longer one of our teams, but we still have some of their music with us. Really good recordings if you like children's songs and that kind of thing. Our music is available on these platforms, Spotify, Apple Music, and Pandora. The way our recordings work, you can get one of these envelopes in the back at the table if you like. You're on a donation basis. You can take one of these, fill it out, send a donation into the office if you like. Or if you want to pay today, we could do cash, check, credit card, however you want to do that. We can take payment today if you want to do that. All right, and now we'll go into the PR video. It's about 7 minutes long, so enjoy that as we take you on a trip.
Crowns before the Lamb of God.
All right, just a few things to go along with that. Some things I would like to announce or talk about. Prison Crusades. And I see a brother back here that his picture was on one of the slides. I don't know if you recognize him or not, but I've seen him in a crusade. And Prison Crusades. I don't know how many here have ever been involved in one of those, but I'm telling you, it's quite a work. Going in and ministering to these guys and seeing the hunger and the appetite for the Word of God, and seeing the fire, the enthusiasm for God. I've said already, sometimes when you come out of those prisons, you're like, boy, if I could just take some of that energy and take it back to our community and plug it in. Now, granted, it's all these guys, they have so much time on their hands, but they know the Bible. Kid yourself. These guys know the Bible, they know where verses are found, and what an incredible experience. So we have a crusade coming up in December in Florida. It's a large crusade. We're completely maxed out as far as volunteers. Registration is full. It's closed. But we do have one coming up in February of next year. A smaller one. It's in North Florida. And so if any of you are interested in getting involved, being a volunteer, you can go on the website and you'll find all the information there that you need. Another thing that we do have some opportunities for staff. If there's anyone here that would like to move to North Carolina for a bit and experience a different scenery, different climate, different people, different occupation, we're looking to fill two positions right now. We're looking for a secretary, preferably a young lady, 18 years or older, to do secretary work. That is a paid position. And then we're also looking for a property maintenance / hospitality couple or young man. The couple that we have there, young married couple, had one child. They recently terminated. And his responsibilities were mowing, trimming bushes, just general maintenance in and outside. Her responsibilities were a lot of cooking, a lot of cleaning, and being sort of a mom to some of her single staff girls. So the position could also be held by a young unmarried fellow, but also by a retired couple. We would love to see that. So that is a BS position. If you're interested, we have flyers in the back. If you're interested in any of those positions, I would love to talk to you about that. And then another thing that we do, you saw some pictures of some international work that we're involved in. Nelson, our founder, is very passionate about the work that's going on in Uganda. They're doing a lot of water wells, going over 3, 4, 5 times a year, doing medical clinics and those kinds of things. But one of the things that we do is we have a sponsorship program. There are many, many needy children over there. There's homeless children by the dozens. And what we do, we have a program that you can take one of these cards, you can sponsor a child, gets the child their education, puts the child in school, because truth be told, many children over there are safer in school than they are at home. Sadly, there's so much abuse by fathers and by relatives and just, wow. So here's an opportunity. I know you have lots and lots of opportunity to sponsor people and do good here's just one more. So the way this works, we currently have about 180 of these that are waiting to be sponsored. Ages vary anywhere from 5 years old to about 18, 17, or 18. And we're looking for a minimum of 1 year sponsors. So what you do is you pick up one of these cards, you find the age, you find the gender you want, and you say, I want to sponsor this child for 1 year. $360 for 1 year. About a dollar a day, isn't it? So you pick up one of these cards, there's a QR code in the back. You scan that QR code, puts you right onto our application, you fill out all the paperwork, and the office will get in touch with you. If you don't want to or don't know how to do the QR code, we have cards in the back that you can simply fill out your information, and that will get taken back to the office and get processed once we get back. But the office will contact you either way, and there'll be ongoing contact with that. But what we're really looking for is sponsors that pick up one of these and say, I want to sponsor this child for the entirety of whatever's left of their school time. So in this case, this young man's name is Ezra. He is 5 years old. He has 14 years left to go to graduate. So that simply means that you would go $360 times 14 years. I know that's a lot of money. But you can do it several ways. If God lays it on your heart, we'd love to talk to you. You can pay that all up front. You can pay yearly. There's several different ways that you can do that. So visit our table in the back. If God lays it on your heart to pick up one of these, sponsor one of these dear children, make a world of a difference in just one child. I know sometimes we look at some of those needs and we always get overwhelmed. It's like, what can I do? What is one child? What's that going to do? Let me tell you, it's one child. It's one soul. That might make a difference in eternity one day. So God bless you if you consider that. Another thing that we have in the back for you, some of you ladies, I don't know how many quilters that there still are. It's sort of a thing of the past, I think. But there may be some quilters here that are looking for something to do this winter. We have a couple quilts in the back that we'd love to show you. What the way this works is you take the quilt, you quilt it, whatever you do to quilt, I guess quilt it. And then it gets sold at our annual auction in Sarasota, Florida. So you're basically quilting it, giving it back to the ministry, and then it gets sold and the proceeds go to international work or whatever those proceeds go for at that point. So we have two quilts in the back. If you're interested, please see us after the service, if you would. All right, I invite you to stand. We're going to go into the Word here for just a moment. And let's see, what could we sing? How about we sing the verse of How Great Thou Art? Can we do that? Oh, Lord, my God,
may I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul,
so much fear, there's so much turmoil when you get into the political world, but I don't even like to go there. I believe this morning that whoever's elected here in the next few weeks, there's going to be some conflict, whether with one way or the other way. I think there's going to be some things that we're going to need to work through. And, you know, we as God's people, we long for revival, do we not? We would love to see our nation fall on its face and fall on their knees and repent and experience revival. We would love to see that as a nation. But you know what? You think about revival. Where does revival start? Does it start in the church? I believe it starts right here. I believe as when we as Christians, on a personal level, experience revival in our heart, then it will impact the churches. And as the churches impact, it impacts the community. As the community is impacted, that impact goes out. So let's not look at the big picture and just long for revival for our country, but let's look into our own hearts. Because that's where God wants to begin to work. You know, all of us probably have things in our lives where we need the Word of God, we need the fire of God to come into our hearts and burn away some of that stuff and experience the revival that really, really is meaningful and that will make a difference in our world. But it starts with us. I don't know if you have your Bibles with you, but I'm going to be turning to some scriptures this morning. Some of these scriptures, I'm going to probably pull them a little bit out of their context. I don't want to do any injustice to God's Word, but I'm just going to lift out a few verses here and there throughout Scripture that just mean so much to me as we read and as we consider what our nation is all about. Because, friends, we would agree that the world is a place of trouble, is it not? And we sang a song this morning that talked about hope. Because of the love of Christ, we have hope for tomorrow. And I love to look out into an audience like this and see that hope. Because we as God's people, friends, if we don't have hope, is there any hope left? And I hope and I trust that as you interact in this community with your neighbors, with your business associates, whoever they are, that when you finish your conversation with them, and they're not Christians, they're left to wonder and they're left to scratch their heads like, wow, what does that person have? Whatever that person had is what I want. And friends, it's the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. So even though we live in a world that has a lot of trouble, a lot of fear, a lot of turmoil, we don't need to be there. We as a family have experienced, I've been so blessed. As we travel the country over and even into other countries, we see and friends, there's so many good people out there. Don't dwell on the negative things. We get a little lopsided sometimes, and we just bemoan the fact that this world is such a terrible place. There's so much wickedness. There's so much violence. Don't go there. There are still a lot of people in the world. And as we travel into communities, we see, sense, and experience the work of Jesus wherever we go. There are people out there, lots of people out there, that are on fire for Jesus Christ and are bent on serving Him. So let's not let the devil discourage us with all the bad stuff that's going on in the world. And sometimes we look at the situation in the world and we think, wow, what can be done? It's time that us as Christians rise up. It's time for God's people to rise up and make a difference. What do we do? The Bible clearly tells us that the most powerful thing we can do, and we'll look at some of those scriptures, is to fall on our face and pray. We have so much. We have so much power. And yet so often we sort of lose sight of that. So turn your Bibles, if you will, to an Old Testament scripture, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. I love this verse. It's a familiar verse. It simply reads like this. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, I will heal their land. I would love to see that. but it starts with something that we call as small as falling on our faces. We need to humble ourselves. We need to pray. We need to seek God's face. And we need to turn from our wicked ways. You know, it's something that we've experienced. We're seeing in North Carolina and Tennessee the devastation and the people that are in such dire, dire trouble. One of the things this storm has done, people that weren't praying before are now praying. People that aren't seeking the face of God are now seeking the face of God. Families have been drawn together. Communities have been drawn together. And I've just been amazed at the outpouring of resources from other communities. I mean, it's got to the point where there are places set up where they take distribution places, have actually put gates across their entrances so that people can't bring more things because there are so many things coming in. It's becoming a problem. It's a good problem. I know of a town in North Carolina that closed their exit because the tractor trailers were coming in with loads and loads of stuff. It's a good problem to have. But now the challenge is how do you distribute this stuff? But the challenge that I have this morning, yes, when we're in calamity, when we face hard things, it's easy for us to turn to God and we seek God. We saw that back when the 9/11. The nation as a whole turned to God. But where is it now? Seems like after things sort of settle down, life becomes normal again, we sort of go back to our normal life, do we not? And I'm afraid that's what's going to happen with this storm. Yes, now people are seeking God. They're in dire situations. But what are we going to do in 5 years from now? Are we going to forget? Here it says that unless we turn from our wicked ways, when we turn from our wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. And then I will forgive their sins. And then I will heal their land. Now turn over to James chapter 5. I love this verse. This is sort of changing, switching gears just for a bit. Sometimes we think, and we already alluded to the fact, sometimes we sort of bemoan the fact, well, what can I do? Our nation's in such a bad shape. What can I do? James chapter 5, verse 16. Oh, let me keep it. Oh, it doesn't make sense. It says, not all of the verse, but the end of the verse says that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth what?
Much.
Effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So as we as a nation, we come to this time of election. Friends, we have a lot of power. Let's get on our faces. Let's get on our knees. And let's intercede for our nation and for our leaders. You know, I think about the account in the Old Testament where Moses was gone for too many days. He was in the mountains with God. God was giving him the Ten Commandments. And the people came to Aaron and they said, "We don't know what happened to Moses, but we need something. We need someone." And, of course, you know the story. Moses said, or Aaron said, "Well, take off your earrings," and he somehow, at least according to his rendering to Moses later, they threw him in the fire and out comes this calf. Moses comes down and, of course, sees what's going on, and God knows what's going on. And if it were not for Moses interceding, I believe God would have destroyed the people. Because he told Moses, he said, "Stand to the side," in own words, he said, "Stand to the side. And I'm going to consume these people." And Moses intercedes for the people. What did God do? Verse 14 says that God repented of his, God repented, not repenting in the sense that he did wrong and had to repent it that way. But I believe it says in the King James Version that God repented and changed his mind in other words. Why? Because of intercession. Because of what Moses did for the people. So I believe in that likeness today. Friends, if all the Christians in America fall on their faces, I believe it will make a difference. The prayers of God's people has so much power and makes such a difference. Now I'd like to turn to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. listen to this verse. This is a familiar verse again. And I would like to read this to you as a church. Oftentimes we look at this verse and sure. Make it personal. To you as a church, to you as a person, in a personal way this morning. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. There you have it, friends. That's what we are called to do. We are chosen by God to make a difference. What is the difference? That we should show forth his praises. We can't impact the whole world, but we can impact our neighbors. We can impact that person that you see tomorrow on the street. Doesn't have to be much. Maybe it's just a smile on your face or a, hey, how are you today? I've been so challenged since I've got to know Nelson and even Dave, but Nelson especially, he's so verbal about his testimony about Jesus. And I remember the first couple of times that we went out for lunch with Dave Miller and Nelson, and it's such a challenge. They'll say to the waiter, are you a Christian? Do you know Jesus? How's your relationship with Jesus? Over Walmart in the checkout line. They'll turn around to the person behind them. Do you know Jesus? Wow, what a challenge. What if we all do that? That's a challenge that has been such a challenge for me. Matthew chapter 5 talks about, maybe I'll turn to that as well. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 through 16. Again, make this personal. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is therefore good for nothing but to be cast out, to be trodden under the foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. There's our call. Let's be salt and light. Let's not hide the light that is in us. We have the Holy Spirit. We have Jesus Christ in our hearts. We have so much, and yet so often, we are the quiet and the lamb. I'm not talking about carrying this in a boastful, arrogant way, but with quiet confidence. We live our life, and that confidence is contagious, I'm convinced. People see that, and people want that. I thought about the account of Esther. You know the account of Esther, how that story goes, and Mordecai sends word to her and says, here's what you got to do, in other words. She says word back and says, if I go into the king and I'm not asked, it could require my life. Mordecai sends this reply back. I better turn to that. I will get that. Yes, Esther chapter 4, verse 14. Here's Mordecai's reply. For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then there shall enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Friends, this morning, every one of us, I believe, have a calling in life. We're not here by accident. There's a reason that you are where you are right now. I don't know what it is. Maybe tomorrow you'll meet someone. Maybe tomorrow you'll have an opportunity. Make good of that opportunity. God has placed you where you are right now for a reason. Maybe you think, well, my life is mundane. Well, how can God use me? Well, if you just go out on the streets, just a smile on your face, just a wave to a whatever, an encouraging word, sometimes that's all it takes. So don't lose heart. Don't ever lose the idea that God has something for you, for every one of us. We're not just here by accident, but we are like Esther was. We are here for a specific reason at this time. Sometimes it's not always clear to us, but as we're faithful, God will reveal that to us. Proverbs 21, verse 1. love this verse as it relates to what we as a nation are facing. Proverbs 21, verse 1 says, "The heart of the king, the king's heart, is in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of waters, he turneth it whithersoever he will." We don't know the mind of God, do we? You know, sometimes we think, God, if you would just give us a good, solid Christian leader, then everything would be okay. Well, the Bible tells us that God's ways are higher than our ways, and we don't always get it right. But whatever God has in mind, and whatever happens in this election, don't forget, the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. And God can make beauty out of ashes. God can take something that's ugly and wicked and whatever. In spite of, God works his purposes. And I love to think about that. That yes, sometimes our hearts, sometimes we see men whose hearts are bent towards wickedness. But God can take that heart and turn it. Wow. At the end of the day, we look back and we're like, wow, it's but God. God's ways are so much higher than our ways. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19, I love this verse, talks about an anchor of the soul. But we have an anchor of the soul. Friends, don't let whatever's going on in the world discourage you. Keep going forward. Keep climbing that ladder. We have an anchor of the soul. Our hope is in Jesus Christ and not our earth. Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. I love this verse as well. There's actually a song, a chorus that I remember as a youngster hearing this song sung. Now this verse, you may be pulling it out of context because it's given in the context of tithing. But it simply reads like this. "Bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. And prove me now, herewith saith the Lord of hosts. For if I will not open you the windows of heaven, and pour you out a blessing, and there shall not be enough room to receive it." The heart of God. God this morning longs to open the windows of heaven. Can you imagine the windows of heaven opened up, and God's blessing being poured out? God longs to do that. But yet we so often, as people, as communities, as churches, as a nation, we need to humble ourselves. And then God will do his part and will be so willing to do his part. All right, I want to share one more verse with you as the family comes up and we're going to finish out the singing this morning. The next song we're going to sing talks about the title of the song is "I'm Not Ashamed." And that song is such a challenge for me as I think about being willing to stand up for Jesus. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Paul says this, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek." The power of God. Think about the power of God. The power that raised Jesus from the dead. Talk about power. The power that takes an old life, an old man, and creates a new man. Old things are become new. Behold, all things are become new. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things are become new. The power of Jesus Christ. And we can look in the Old Testament. We can look at the miracles that were done when Jesus was here. The power that it took. Yet Jesus so easily, with a spoken word, with a touch, whatever, worked miracles. The power of Jesus Christ. Friends, we have that power available to us today. But the most powerful thing that we have is to fall on our face and intercede for each other and to pray for each other and to lift each other to the throne of grace. And revival begins right here. And then revival spreads. Would to God that our nations, our churches, first of all, our communities would experience that kind of revival. So as we sing the next song, think about the words of the song. "I am not ashamed to stand up and say that I'm a Christian." There are times in probably all of our lives where it would be just easier to just sort of sit on the shelf. And yes, we go to church, and we're good people, we're kind neighbors, we do all kinds of good things, but is that enough? Sometimes Jesus is calling us to more than that, to get off the shelf, and to get into the battlefield, and to fight for him through prayer. The battle's already been won. All we need to do is plug into it and avail ourselves as the most powerful thing that there is. I'm not ashamed to be called a Christian.
Sometimes we as Christians, we wait for the shepherd. That Jesus faced was as he's there in the garden, he's there in Gethsemane before the Father, just hours before his crucifixion. And he's there and he's on his knees and possibly on his face before the Father. And he's looking into the cup. And he sees in the cup, he sees sin. He sees my sin. Yes, it was thousands of years ago, but my sins, friends, were in that cup. And so were yours. The sins of the whole world. And Jesus knew at that moment, in order to fulfill the plan of the Father, he would need to drink that cup and become sin for us. Imagine, Jesus, the guiltless, innocent Son of God, I believe, would become guilty before God for the first time ever. Jesus didn't know what guilt was, but when he drank that cup and became sin for us, I believe he was separated, in a sense, from God. I think that's why it was so difficult for Jesus as he's there and he's like, Father, if it's possible, if there's any other way, would you remove this cup from me? And I believe the struggle was real, friends. The mad part of Jesus, I believe the struggle was real. It wasn't like, oh, it's the Son of God. Yeah, it's no big deal. Friends, this was the mad part of Jesus. It was a real struggle for him. The Bible says that his agony was so great that his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood. But you know, it's so beautiful at the end. He comes to a place of surrender. And he says, Father, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And I suppose this morning that all of us have come to that place of surrender. It's a beautiful place. It's where we find rest. It's where we find peace. And we can just say, Father, whatever. The place of surrender. The next song we're going to sing is a song that talks about the blood of Jesus again. It's an old familiar song, paid in full by the blood of the Lamb. Brothers and sisters, friends, this morning, there is no other way. It's only through the blood that we can have our sins washed away. Imagine with me this morning in heaven, there's this large book. And in that book, there are pages. And every page has a name on the top. You have a page in that book. And God the Father walks over to that book, and he turns the pages, and he finds your page, and he sees your name at the top. There it is. There's your life. There on that page is everything that you've ever done. Every sin you've ever committed. Every evil thought you've ever had. Every evil imagination. It's all there. For most of us, in fact, for all of us, it's ugly. Because we are so unworthy. We do so many things outside of the power that Jesus Christ gives to us. Our lives are not worthy. But you know what? I love to think about when we accept the plan of salvation, when we invite Jesus into our heart, when his blood is applied to our lives. Now that God the Father walks over and he looks at your page, what does he see? Paid in full. All he sees on that page is a nice white page, completely wrinkle-free, completely spot-free. No tears, no smudges. Big red letters. Paid in full by the blood of God. What happened? I don't know what happened. somehow these sins and these spots and these wrinkles are gone from my life. And I can stand before God as if I had never even committed a sin. Isn't that something? Only through the blood of Jesus Christ. What does your life look like today? If God looks at your life, if God looks at your page, what does he see? I hope and I trust, and it's my prayer that everyone in this building, when he looks at your life, he sees nothing but the blood. The old things are gone. In fact, the Bible says that when he forgives our sins, he forgets them. He remembers them no more. Certainly doesn't hold us accountable anymore. And we walk in freedom. We walk as new creatures in Christ Jesus. Paid in full by the blood of the Lamb. Friends, we're not here to stay. We seek a better country, do we not? We don't know how far away that is, but we do know that heaven is for real. I remember 40 years ago, my parents and the evangelist saying, you better get ready to die because Jesus is coming soon. Well, 40 years ago, the scoffers would say, so much for that, right? No, we as believers know better than that, do we not? Just because Jesus hasn't returned when people have predicted in the past doesn't mean he's not coming. Jesus is coming soon, and I believe it. We see the signs of the times, and I believe the Bible says that when we see these things happen, lift up your eyes because your redemption
Charles and I. I don't think it's far away. Maybe 5 years, maybe 20 years. It could be
100 years. I don't know how, but it could be, I suppose. But nonetheless, Jesus is coming soon. And even aside from that, we're not promised tomorrow, are we? In fact, we're not promised our next breath. The very breath that we pull into our lungs, the next breath that you pull into your lungs, if God would decide not to give it to you, you would topple out of your seat and you'd be done. We have no promise. So it behooves us, and it's urgent, friends, that we live our lives in such a way that when that time comes, we can go to be with the Lord. We don't need to be afraid. But I suppose that there's those of you that have lost loved ones. We think of meeting our loved ones again in heaven someday. What a thought. Reunited with our loved ones, friends, parents, siblings, spouses, children, grandparents. Someday we can be in glory together and we can walk the streets of glory with Moses, with Abraham, with Peter. Can you imagine? But to see Jesus Christ, one day we'll be able to see Jesus Christ and to look him in the face. Thank you for taking my sins. Thank you for suffering for me. Because friends, this morning, if it's not for the blood of Jesus Christ, we are lost. We are headed to a place that we don't want to go to because of Jesus. One day, we will be able to show our gratitude and say thank you. In the Sweet By and By, it's an old familiar song. When we come to the end of the song, we're going to repeat the chorus. And I invite you at that point to stand up. Help us sing the last chorus when we get to the end. So the foyer offering will be in the sweet.